Good afternoon. Please take your seats. So, good afternoon. My name is Peter Dublon. I'm with USAID. And I hate to disappoint you, but I know you all came to see Vice President Stephen Groff. Unfortunately, he is not well, and you'll have to put up with me facilitating the final session. And this is a fantastic session. And we're going to start with interactive participation. You all have a clicker on your seats. If you're sitting on top of it, stand up and hold it in either your right or your left hand. And we're going to go into a survey so we can get to know a little bit more about who we are and what our priorities are. Okay. Okay, so basically you click once, preferably. You can only answer one question, and we'll give you about 30 seconds to process and
go.
Just for my own edification, how many people have been to at least six ACEFs? Raise your hand. Okay. The old timers. Okay. Next. Since we partner now and we have 32 partners on the deep dive workshops, people are coming for the deep dives but staying, so I'm very happy to see that. Next. Okay, we got a couple more, three or four more, next. Why are you here? Seeing this, I wonder what people think about the validity of electronic voting. Numbers are up there. Okay, so I'm going to do a quick wrap up, and then we're going to go into the panel discussion. I want to check and see Jessica, are all the track chairs here?
Yes.
Okay. So we're running a little behind. So I have some words of wisdom to summarize what happened, but I think you've all been here and hopefully you've been reading the newsletter. We've had some fantastic discussions on putting energy efficiency first, on technological disruption, on whether we need more regulation or smarter regulation or to work in unregulated places. We had some very good discussion yesterday about the NDCs and two sessions of that actually. And so I have some quotes, which I think are worth going through briefly, and then we're going to hear from the track chairs, who are going to briefly summarize the main takeaways. First, ADB President Nakao said, we should reduce fossil fuel subsidies, which encourage the overuse of energy and distort the market by making fossil fuels cheaper. He also said that ADB is scaling up its operations in clean energy. Last September, ADB announced that they will double their annual climate financing to $6 billion by 2020. Of this, $4 billion will be for mitigation and $2 billion will be for adaptation. Ambassador Goldberg, United States Ambassador to the Philippines, said, moving forward, our assistance for low emission development strategies will play a fundamental role in helping countries to implement their national contributions and in crafting increasingly ambitious targets for greenhouse gas reductions. We have Rachel Kite, CEO of Sustainable Energy for All, said, she challenged us, she said, do we have the courage to imagine what it would be like if we were successful in achieving our sustainability and climate goals in the next 10 years? She also said, efficiency must come first, it's the cheapest fuel source and is available to everyone. Barbara Chrysler of Phillips Lighting said one of the easiest to remember and most effective quotes of the week, we need to move from paper to practice, from talk to action. The second part was mine. She also said, we stand at the edge of a revolution in which the energy efficient light bulb will be at the center of the Internet of Things. And Bartosz Wojcik said, we will not be able to meet the demands of sustainability by innovating in the traditional way. He said that disruptive clean energy technologies cannot be commercialized through policies and regulations, which some of us who do policy and regulation found to be a little challenging. He also said that by 2017, crowdfunding will exceed the total of venture capital and private finance. So that's the Bartlett quotations of ACEF 2017. We're going to go now to messages from the track chairs, and I'm going to ask them to stand up and read. I asked them to distill the discussions over the last 3 days into four or five takeaway points. So first I'll call on Mark Lister. He's with the Energy for All Global Energy Efficiency Accelerator and the Danish Energy Efficiency Center. Copenhagen Energy Efficiency Center. Mark.
Thank you, Peter. And it's appropriate that I'm reporting to you from the left side of the room where we had some great discussions in Zone A here on energy efficiency. Can I just thank ADB quickly and the steering committee for bringing me here as track chair this year, and also all of our session chairs who I think convened a great discussion. The 4 points that we took away, obviously difficult to summarize such a wide-ranging and vibrant discussion into 4 points. But I've done that here, and the first one is no surprise, you've heard it already. We need to put energy efficiency first. We know that efficiency can deliver half of the emissions required to achieve a well below 2 degrees target. But without efficiency, we won't be able to go as far as we need to in achieving our other goals in renewable energy and energy access. Efficiency is increasingly understood as a kind of a multiplier that works as an invaluable contribution not only to clean energy but other wide-ranging objectives, economic productivity, air quality, public health. The second point, building on the first point, is that it's time to think big. We heard about some very well understood issues of implementation and moving to action. We know what the issues are in energy efficiency. We're still bogged down with operational barriers and perception gaps at the project level. So if energy efficiency really is integral to these goals, to our other goals, then it demands more attention. It demands more resources. And we really need this to accelerate what we know about aggregating projects and really taking things up a level so we can build confidence of the traditional institutional funds and heavy energy users, because only then will we see the order of magnitude shift that we're talking about and that we require. The third point is that we have to act fast to assemble the pieces of this energy efficiency puzzle. But the good news is that we actually already have all the pieces. We know we have technologies that work. We know we have business models that work. And globally, this is now about stronger models of collaboration, backed with efforts to work through the inertia at the local level to raise awareness and forge agreements. Data and technologies are key measurement techniques that can build confidence for all the players in the market, and in turn gives confidence to the key finance sector. And the more complete this puzzle is, the more of a picture we have, the more robust a message we can communicate about the important contribution of energy efficiency to the global energy transformation. And the last summary point that I have is that we have to build global mechanisms, but we have to put the power in the hands of local actors. We've heard a lot about the fact that real action takes place at the local level, with cities at the front line of creating the right business climate. And there's many efforts underway at the local level between business, civil society, sub-national jurisdictions, everywhere. We have to connect these with global goals. We have to create empowerment through access to better guidance on technology, policy, and finance. And we need to improve peer-to-peer networks, cities sharing with other cities, best practice with other people who can learn from that, so that we can create this change in behaviour and in tools towards regionally harmonised approaches to create a really turbocharged local action towards the goals that we know we have to reach. That's our report back from energy efficiency. Thanks a lot, Ben.
Thank you. Thank you. Next we're going to go on to Yong Chen of IRENA, who's going to relay the messages from the Renewable Energy Tribe.
Thank you very much. We have a privilege for me to report to the plenary of what we discussed at the under Renewable Energy Tribe. We have six sessions, have a very vibrant and fruitful and discussions, and it's always a daunting task to really cover all of them. I will try my best to have four points. And first is the energy miracle is already here. In 2015, it has witnessed 147 gigawatts of renewable power capacity added to the largest annual increase ever. A new record in the high in renewable energy investment dramatically enhanced cost competitiveness achieved through competition, innovation, economies of scale, and improved long-term policy certainty, attributable largely to the wide adoption of Paris Agreement. Apart from renewable electricity, bioenergy, renewable energy for cooling, heating, transport sectors present huge untapped potentials, especially in Asia, which will generate not only indigenous energy sources, but also local opportunities, job opportunities, among other benefits. So this comes first, the message will be delivered to the plenary. And second is the importance of good energy planning. Well begun is half done. Good energy planning is the key to successful and cost-effective integration of variable renewables. However, to do good energy planning, the data is important. The location-specific renewable energy resource data is still much needed, especially in this region, still busy. And for private sector, want revenues, want money, take a systematic and an innovation approach to create multiple values over different time scales. And energy storage, marine energy prospects, and the third-party PPP model have showcased economic viability if a value added can be properly contextualized. Together, a healthy environment for innovation, allowing the learning from mistakes and failures is also required. Together, public sectors and the multi-development banks such as ADB can and should have an important role to play. So this innovations, and innovations should be fostered through and also learn, encourage learn from learning by doing, but also learning from mistakes and failures that need to be unlocked. This message. And the last message, transformation is happening in transport sector, especially in Asia. And there is a high potential to adopt cleaner transportation technologies that include electric vehicle and the biofuels. Just as one example, there's over 100 million e-scooters can be expected to be on the road by 2018 in Asia alone. Such solutions are also attractive in islands and remote areas where the diesel prices are very high, as we know. However, battery charging and life cycle management need to be factored in at the very beginning. A role that, again, the public sector and also multi-development banks can and should play. That's the fourth key message or highlights I would like to report to the panel, plenary.
Thank you. Next, Davida Wood, who chaired the ACEF tribe.
Thanks so much for the AEP for an opportunity to be the chair of the Energy Access Track. We had amazing discussions and also had one-on-one conversations with the panelists, and were really fascinating. not to do them justice to my points, but this is what the top line messages are. The first one is that scaling is not receiving enough attention. This is a theme that came up in almost every one of the five panels that were part of the track. At the project level, there are encouraging success stories. Project developers are becoming increasingly more sophisticated about data collection to characterize demand and understand consumers' needs for decentralized solutions. But there's a disconnect between these efforts and national planning efforts. And without this data, governments have a suboptimal understanding of the demand for decentralized energy services and cannot build these needs into national plans that could support scaling these projects. At the same time, governments can do more to share the data they already have on resource availability and socioeconomic activity in a form that could support entrepreneurial efforts to scale. Second point is about mini-grids. There's a mixed outlook. On the one hand, like I heard a lot of examples about mini-grids having recent success in powering productive uses. For example, there are good examples of mini-grids that serve rice mills and computer centers that are financially sustainable. But not surprisingly, revenue from providing services to last mile households is still elusive. There are tools such as Homer, though, that can be helpful in understanding the costs of using different technologies, the optimal scale of penetration, and even how to develop tariffs and subsidies that benefit the poor while still remaining financially viable. So I actually had heard of Homer before, but didn't really understand how it could even address issues like tariffs and subsidies. So I think there's a lot going on there that there could be more awareness building around. Third one is about gender segregation. I really have the sense that it's becoming mainstream due to efforts of the EDD, World Bank, Sustainable Energy for All, and also project developers. Gender assessments are moving from a niche approach into the mainstream. Important case studies are emerging of gender analysis being integrated into rural electrification efforts. Most encouraging, women are being integrated not only as consumers, but also as producers of energy. For example, managing biomass mini-grids or being masons for biogas digesters. So there's a job training component here, and including women in job training for delivering energy access at a local level is having an impact. The fourth point is about clean cookstove dissemination. Even after three decades of dissemination programs, only 33% of the 3 billion consumers of solid fuels are using improved cookstoves. We need a systems approach to clean cookstoves that takes into account the value chain of traditional biomass use, cooking habits, and the multiple uses of traditional cookstoves, for example, lighting or insect repellent. Community involvement is key, and women should, of course, be included, but there are sometimes surprising local champions. For example, in the Philippines, religious groups have environmental ministries that make them natural allies to this sort of effort. And the last point is about the grid. Grid reliability is essential to moving up the energy ladder. Billions of dollars are being invested in expanding the grid, but are these investments yielding the desired results? A minimum of 6 hours of reliable service per day is needed for consumers to invest in appliances and equipment for productive uses. Yet there is limited data available to monitor the availability and reliability of the grid. Independent monitoring can be used to improve accountability for these capital expenditures.
Thank you. And last but certainly not least, Dan Nelson from TransEnergy. So a couple of important things you need to know about him. He used to work at ADB. Second thing is he wasn't fired. He left voluntarily. Third thing is he's the one giving away the iPad, so be nice to him.
I was described as an unreformed retiree, but also I had, in a previous lifetime, I was an independent mercenary geologist working in the oil and gas business. Track 4 has been an independent experiment, and the genesis was really about, you know, now that we've got sustainable development goals and COP21 behind us, the paradigm for talking about clean energy has been updated. So we've got, you know, this broader force of sustainability, and there's a single tree of climate change, and there's a tree of renewable energy, energy efficiency, access to energy. you know, that helps a lot, especially in ADD's operational context and multilateral development bank operational context. So before getting on to Mars, the way I want to preface this is to quote one of America's greatest philosophers. You may not have heard of him, the late great Yogi Berra, who said, in terms of forecasting, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. So we've already heard already that policymaking is an imperfect science, and regulators have struggled to keep up with rapid technological advances, especially in solar. We're also seeing coming up now is energy storage technology, rapid. Energy storage technology, batteries, we heard about some interesting developments in hydrogen. We also heard three different mentions of biomass, carbon capture and storage, advanced biomass technology processing that could substitute for coal. Douglas Bartosz mentioned that, and then a third speaker under track four talk about bio-coal. And these all seem to be three people speaking from different starting points in different contexts. And so specifically with respect to carbon capture and storage, the prospect of using this advanced biomass processing and doing bio-coal, we can look at carbon capture, utilization, and storage in terms of a wholesale change in the fuel supply chain, which isn't what's being done right now. All of the CCS demonstration projects are very complex technologies, new power plants or power plants being retrofitted that are also generally coupled with enhanced oil recovery. Of the 40 demonstration projects expected to be online by next year, 23 of them are enhanced oil recovery. So I'm personally very skeptical about most of the stuff I've been hearing about CCS, but what I'm hearing about biocoal, I think is a much more elegant solution that's going to be a lot easier to do quickly and at sufficient scale. If we don't get speed and scale, we can't weaponize anything in the war on climate change. Speed and scale. The other is that because of the rapid technological advances, when we get to have transformation, we need to have disruptions and disintermediation. So my concept for this is DDT, not the pesticide. Disruption, disintermediation, and transformation. Now we can try to drive that, and we've tried to drive that, but what's happened, Bartosz used the term digital Darwinism. It's gonna happen. There is a fourth industrial revolution happening, and probably most of us don't even recognize that it's going on, but it's happening, and we can't stop it. Even if Donald Trump is elected president next year, I can tell you with more than 100% certainty, the coal-fired power industry in the United States of America is dying a natural death, and the coal mining industry is not far behind it. One more point that I'd make really punctuate this idea of the transformation that's going on. I think just within the last couple of months, in the same week, the world's largest coal mining company, Peabody Energy, and one of the world's largest solar companies, First Edison, both declared bankruptcy within the same week. So the other two points in terms of mobilizing financing, we're talking about projects, start putting money on the table. Develop finance institutions need to be more creative and come up with some new financing instruments so that they can leverage more of the public sector money and money channeled through the private sector operations. And we need leverage ratios of about 3-4 on top of the multilateral development bank money to service the needed investments in renewable energy and energy efficiency. Lastly, the most important point that we heard again and again in every one of the sessions under track four is that we need to engage and empower stakeholders so that government leaders can try and future-proof development outcomes, so as Rachel Kite told us, so that no one is left behind. So overall, its access to information is the single most important factor to enable changes in public behavior. And without that change in public behavior, we're not going to see the transformation necessary at sufficient scale and speed to win the war on climate change. Thanks.
So I think what you saw there, it might have been a bit of a slog hearing four people speak, but what you saw there was incredibly valuable. You saw four people who were thought leaders in their area, backed up by a great team pulling the abstracts together, organizing this event, and by all of you who were presenting, and also by the rapporteurs who were capturing this, so that you leave here and you have some focus instead of, oh, it was great, I heard about 85 different things. We will make those messages available in an ACEF report and also on the website. And I would like the track chairs to stand and also the rapporteurs, just so we can give them a hand of applause, please. So now we're going to move into the panel discussion, and I'll just ask the panelists to please come to the stage. Athena Ronquillo-Ballesteros, who is the director of the Finance Center for the World Resources Institute. Next to her is Aurelia Micko. She's the deputy director of the Regional Environment Office of USAID's Regional Development Mission for Asia. To my left, your right, is Soma Dutta, and she's you've been here several times, three times. She is program coordinator for Women's Economic Empowerment with Energia, the International Network on Gender and Sustainable Energy, and she's one of the most prolific contributors, doing deep dive workshops, special sessions, presenting, chairing sessions, so thank you for coming back. We have a new guest from Germany, Dr. Edmund Lurch, who's the head of systems dynamics from Siemens AG in Germany. And finally, at the end, the familiar face of Yongping Zai, who's the energy czar, can I say that? The senior advisor for energy for the Asian Development Bank. Okay. So what we're going to do, the purpose of doing this is to try to put a cap on the week and get a variety of perspectives on what we have heard, what we think are the key issues, what are priority messages for you. And they will be a bit different because the panelists have different perspectives and different roles. They've reflected on what they've seen. They've reflected on what we've heard over just the last few minutes. This will lead into a wonderful closing plenary by Ralph Sims, who's gonna once again sew it all up and provide us the vision as he did last year. This year he only has 20 minutes though. So we're going to go for about, say, 40 minutes, and we're going to start with opening remarks, first with Athena.
Thank you, Peter, and as you Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, thank you, Peter. I don't know what ACEF would look like if Peter retires from his 11-year stellar career organizing ACEF. I just have to say that after 7 years of attending ACEF, this is the first year that I went to a huge number of pre-forum activities because I was not an organizer. I was simply a student and a sponge trying to absorb everything I can. And the quality of the deep dive workshops, I think, is spectacular. And I just want to congratulate everybody. Most of you are still here. I stand by the tagline of ACEF, that this is a premier learning platform on clean energy. And it's nice to take a step back and listen to all of you experts in the room. And because we've been doing this for a couple of years and trying to wrap up what we've learned or key takeaways, it's becoming really challenging to figure out, you know, what to say in any closing plenary. But because we are passionate in the work we do, I still found two major takeaways. One is, I think all the track chairs emphasize the takeaway around the need to scale and the challenges around scaling. But the other message that permeated or we heard in the halls of ACEF this week is the sense of urgency. I think each and every plenary speaker reminded us of the urgency to stop climate change, to keep emissions below 1.5 degrees, to unlock all existing finance, technological, and capacity building barriers in the system in order to make that clean energy transition. The innovation also in the future track this year is that I think there were a lot of conversations post Paris and post SDGs about how we help countries implement and meet their nationally determined contributions or national climate change action plans. Many of you have heard of the ambitious Asia Pacific targets. These are big targets, you know, several countries committing to 100% renewables, clean energy transition. Three of the biggest and the highest greenhouse gas emitting Asia Pacific nations, China, India, and Indonesia, exceeding the targets of the IEA new policy scenario. So there's a real opportunity to really make big change in the next couple of years. And as Manish Vakna from WR reminded us, we have 2 or 3 years to keep this political momentum going, where governments have our attention, our meaning civil society, private sector, parliamentarians, the financial community. So we need to find a way to get the entire ecosystem of players working together to nail this problem. We should be gathering here 5-6 years from now in the Philippines, where our energy mix may be not completely transformed, but we have tipped the balance such that renewable energy, particularly geothermal, wind, and solar, have taken off exponentially because the cost of technology has gone down. The enabling and policy environment is there, and the incentives are there for the private sector. So it has to be a different conversation 5 to 6 years from now. The second thing that I found really interesting, this is, I think someone said this to me as well, this is my favorite part of ACEF. ADB and USAID and all our other partners managed to convene a group of incubators and accelerators at ACEF. They had deep dive conversations during the pre-forum. An investment accelerator group even did a huge event outside ACEF. I'm excited about this. I think this young entrepreneurs and innovators are promoting business models that will spur innovation. These accelerators are building tomorrow's leading clean tech business. And one of the things I'm hopeful is that maybe in the next 2 or 3 years of convening, the accelerators and the innovators get to have a direct dialogue with energy ministries and utilities and the financial sector. Because I think we need to change the way we think about energy policy and planning in many of our countries. And I think that will make a difference.
So if you have a direct dialogue between the accelerators and the regulators, will we have faster regulation? We heard that regulation isn't keeping up with the exponential rate of technological change. Just wondering. Aurelia.
I am just a pleasure to be here. For me, the opportunity to reflect is really both a personal one and an institutional one. I represent the U.S. government, the USAID, more specifically here working on regional issues. And I have somehow managed to be a part of ACEF for the last 10 years through a variety of different roles. So watching this community, watching who comes here, what the session tracks are, what are we focusing on, what are the questions, what are the dialogues, has just been fascinating. And very much the future that we've dared to imagine a decade ago is here. And so many of you have said that, so many of you reflected on it. And so for me, that part of the reflection is daring to imagine that next future. And having the courage to really do this all the time. And seeing what institutions such as the USAID, what do we do now that the future we imagined 10 years ago is here? And there are so many, such amazing brain power, such amazing energy in the room. All of you is what makes ACEF great. And every year there's something else that just blows my mind. So, and Athena has mentioned a couple of these things that I'm going to, I won't repeat those, I'm just going to emphasize a couple of points. So this idea of course, the Paris Convention and what do we do with that? And USAID specifically, we play a role where we do the things that the private sector doesn't want to do, right? We do the things that there is no money in making, such as the regulatory work, the energy sector planning, bringing the TA, so I encourage you to think along with us. So, make sure that you tell us when the time comes to push us out of some sectors that we're working on that we shouldn't be, and that we need to focus on the things that people don't want to work on. Because COP21 to action, that needs to happen now. And it also needs to happen not just for energy. So, in my sale of daring to imagine a future also has a lot more actors involved in those conversations that we have up to this point. And the second one is I'm already imagining what that amazing pre-forum event, getting the innovators, getting the accelerators, incubators together with the utilities. That will be a fascinating forum and sparks will be flying in many different ways. So it would be great to see if change happens any faster after that discussion. And another thing that I've been reflecting on a lot this week is just how hard it is to imagine and kind of daring to dream beyond the horizon. It is really, a lot of what we focused on in this forum are those changes that need to happen in the next 5 to 10 years, the incremental changes. We haven't internalized this daring to imagine what 50 years from now might look like. And that's really hard, and I have to bring that home. We design programs, there's renewable energy programs worth anywhere between 100 and probably, I was trying to do a back of an envelope accounting, between $100 and $200 million in the region that just USAID is looking at designing moving forward. And very much that incremental change versus that very transformative change, we haven't quite internalized that in our programming. We haven't quite taken the risk necessary to get us there. And the fourth and last thing is just, watching this, the institutions that have been part of this change and what it takes to change and bringing those lessons learned from the renewable energy sector to the sustainable landscape sector, to the adaptation sector. I'm looking at it very much from the point of view of a climate practitioner, having worked on these issues for a while. Where are those barriers? Where do we push next? Where do we bring in the lessons learned from renewable energy to make investments in sustainable landscapes happen? And how do we learn not to make business? This is the sector that's, I love, it's renewable energy minus 20. And how do we make it renewable energy minus 5? How do we speed up that process and bring those lessons much faster than we have? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Like I said, this is my third ACEF. I think the first was 2010, 15, and 16. And apart from the smart apps that we're all being trained to use for including the voting and even to set up meetings, I think we've come a long way. Some of the changes that I see happening are a very vibrant and energetic discussion on access, which has been growing over the years. In fact, I'm surprised to learn in the voting then, which is only 15% people said access was their primary sort of area. So either the energy in the room was so high that it made people think that there were more people in access, or everybody is interested in access, both of which are very good. So the other change that I'm seeing is the increase is of course a high number of women in the room, and also the high number of civil society organizations. And I represent one of them. So going beyond ACEF, and I want to discuss that slightly because the ACEF is really situated in what we are doing in the region, I think we have plenty to pat ourselves on the back about, including the economic growth and the you know, the millions of people that have been lifted out of poverty and so on. But to me, something still lacks, and that really is the inequalities and disparity, which do not really show any signs of reducing. So we're talking about in energy access, we're talking about disparities at, you know, that transcend all levels. We're talking about disparities between countries, we're talking about disparities between rural and urban, we have disparities between men and women, between the main village and the hamlet, and everywhere. So it's just all pervading. It is also a huge disparity to me that people in rural areas are actually spending way more on energy access, and what they're getting is substandard, unsafe, and polluting in terms of energy service. It is also a disparity to me that a woman in 2016 actually has to spend 40% of her waking time in tasks that can be really made easier if we did have energy access. So these are some of the things I think we need to temper our, temper our mood with. Having said that, in this ACEF, and I'm really talking specifically about access because that's what I understand a little bit of, a few things that came up consistently through all discussions was, first is the role of community. And the second point that came up in all discussions was the potential of mini and micro grids, the role of women in expanding energy access, and finally the criticality of productive uses if energy is to be used as an enabler for poverty reduction. So having said that, these points were also mentioned by Davida, I see four major points where energy access initiatives need to go. The first is, I think from now on, we need to make the last mile the first. Essentially what I'm saying is that the low-hanging fruits have been plugged already in energy access. And if they haven't been plugged, then we have a very vibrant private sector and innovators that will do so. But it is really the people in villages, people in remote islands, people in indigenous communities that are not getting energy access. And if we are to meet the 2030 goal of universal energy access, that group needs to be addressed now, and that group will need special treatment. And that is something that I think we need to build into our business as usual strategy itself. Which takes me to the second point where I think we need more investments, which is in investing in women as energy entrepreneurs. This again is an issue that came up throughout the access track, not just in the gender sessions, but several sessions that actually demonstrated experiences where they were talking about community-based energy systems. They did talk about women, engaging women. So, of course, I have an interest in talking about this, but to people who are not sold already on this idea, there are at least three compelling reasons why we need to engage women more closely in energy access efforts. The first is that women are engaged in a large number of small and micro enterprises across developing countries, and these really provide a very ready springboard for jumping energy access efforts. The second reason is that women, especially in rural and remote areas, are operating in geographies where men do not, where men are not that active. Through their networks, through their excellent communication and social networking, they're really able to reach the last mile. They are the people who are not likely to migrate, so they're very much there. And if you look at the private sector, which is not reaching them, then it is these networks that are able to reach the last mile. And the final sort of rationale for engaging in women in development finance is that women make very pro social investment. So when you invest in a woman, when a woman has income in her hands, there is data that shows that 90% of that income actually goes back into the family and community, mostly for education and for girls' education. So there is, I think, a very strong reason for why we should be investing in that area. The third point I wanted to talk about is clean cooking. We are just not making any progress in clean cooking. Clean cooking is just as important as electrification. We have 4.3 million deaths every year, which are attributable to cooking with biomass and inefficient cook stoves. If you look at the progress in the last 10-15 years, we have actually made a negative, the growth rate, if you compare to population growth, has actually been negative. Now combine this to the fact that about 150 countries today have renewable energy targets, but almost all of them are for power. There's very little country-level commitment that's happening on clean cooking. So something needs to be done there, and I think that area is definitely something that needs to be accelerated and accelerated fast. Yeah. Finally, I want to say that it's also very clear that the challenges that I highlighted are all pretty big, and no one can do this alone. We do need to build partnerships. We need to build partnerships at the highest level, but also at the bottom. And when we're talking about partnerships here, in ACEF, there are at least four elements that need to come together. The first is community, which is at the center stage of everything. The second is the service provider, utility, bookstore provider, or whoever. The third is a financing mechanism or some financing system that will buy down the risk, that will mitigate the risk of operating in those remote areas. And finally, of course, there is the enabling framework. I just want to give one example of where this partnership came about very strongly. Solar Care in Africa is providing working with small plug-and-play solar devices, which are used extensively for health services. So they're used for headlights, for fetal heart monitors, and refrigeration of vaccinations and so on. But this is possible only because the energy sector is working very closely with the health sector. So that is something I want to emphasize in building partnerships at the most local to the most global. We need that throughout. I also wanted to highlight one last point, which is that small finance is just as important as big finance. We are seeing a large number of big financing initiatives which are great, which will go towards rural electrification and electrification in general. But for me, I find it easier to raise money or raise finances at that level than to raise finance for a single entrepreneur at the village level who actually needs $500. So I do want to drive home this point that small finance needs just as much attention as big finance, and it's just not available. It is simply not available. With that, I think I'll end, but I do want to thank Peter and his and the rest of ACES for having me here. Thank you.
Thank you for that. We're going to segue to a completely different part of the energy sector, which is grid-connected renewable energy and integration of renewable energy. But before we do, I just think it's a very sobering assessment, given that it could be easy to pat ourselves on the back. And I remember in 2007 and 2008, there'd be a few people in the crowd saying, "You're paying too much attention to large-scale renewable energy. There's no one here talking about access." Now there's 1,500 people here, 15%, there's 250 at least, there's probably 500. It is vibrant. One of the, besides the accelerator, I think the second most exciting thing here this week was the Energy for All Investor Forum. There were real investors looking at business models, having meetings afterwards in hotels, but what you lay out clearly is it's not enough. We have to even work harder and smarter, so thank you for that. And Dr. Lurch, thank you for coming all the way from Germany, and we're interested to hear your reactions on the week and then also your perspectives based on your extensive experience.
Yeah, I'm from Germany, as you heard. In Germany we have a huge penetration of renewables, and at the end I can say it works. I and I'd like to share a little bit the experience that we had, how we had to rebuild our system so that we are able to let it run in the way as we have it. We started as every system with base load, hard code, nuclear power plants, and then we had a totally change in the energy philosophy in our system. It was our Renewable Energy Act several years ago, and then and with this Renewable Energy Act, we gave the renewables first priority to infeed into the system. All other sources were of secondary class. Renewables were the number one in our system. This was totally new. Philosophy was changed. We did not know how to deal with many things. We had to learn a lot. And then we had another milestone. Our Chancellor Angela Merkel decided to change the policy of our nuclear power plants. So we will retire until 2020 all our nuclear power plants. We will peak load of 80 megawatts and we will retire 25 gigawatt nuclear plant. This is a huge change in the power mix in our system. With these elements, step by step, we developed our renewable philosophy. We have now 25% of our renewables in the south, more or less photovoltaic, connected to medium and low voltage systems. The other 25% is located in the north at the Baltic Sea and at the North Sea. On and offshore, we started a lot of offshore plants with large size. We have several offshore power plants, size 200 to 400 megawatt. And we sent this power by PC lines to shore, and we have built new AC lines in the system to transport and distribute the power. What we need is a lot of flexibility in the system. We have a huge amount of redispatch in the system. We load our lines from the north to the centers of loads in the center of Germany, in the south of Germany, very heavily. And we decided to build a totally new transportation system. We start with a DC line from north to south in the German system on AC towers. So we have AC towers with AC double lines, and we disconnect one of this AC line and connect the DC line on the same tower. Electrical engineers know this is a tricky thing, right, to work with like this. We want to install four of these lines from the north to the south. And the target is to interconnect the DC lines together to the multi-terminal DC system. What is the reason for this? When you have a multi-terminal DC system, you can control the power flow. Wherever you infeed, you can take the power out wherever you like to have it. And this reduces drastically the redispatch in the system. And it helps us to balance the demand of loads and the infeed in the different parts of the system. We have changed a lot of in the medium and in the low voltage systems. For example, we have installed low voltage transformers with on-load step changers to stabilize the voltage. This is a totally new element. I think there are not so many countries that use low voltage transformers with on-load tap changers. We changed our philosophy which stakeholders have to support the system by ancillary services. We have a so-called German grid agency. This has developed a roadmap that each and every source in the system support these ancillary services, which means supports reserve, supports frequency, reserve, supports voltage in the system. This is totally new. Up to now, there is no support from our renewable sources. but we learned it's necessary when you retire more and more for conventional power plants that every stakeholder has to support the system. This is also something that we have learned. And we change and adapt our rules depending on the actual demand. Actually, last week we have changed a little bit our new Energy Act so that the share of power is a little bit modified. It helps to support the actual situation of the system. So what can we learn? Very simple. We are a very part of the European system, 80 gigawatt compared to about 700 gigawatt in Europe, helps us a lot when we have fluctuation, when we have huge flows in the system, so our neighbors support our system. Try to connect with your neighbors and this reduces the block of problems to the system. The other thing is share all auxiliary services with all sources. There are no exotic sources like renewables or conventional sources. Each and every source is a source in the system and it helps to produce power and self-contained. And make your system flexible. This is very important. The more flexible the system is, the better you can react on different situations. What we, for example, do is we combine different sources together. Wind together with pump storage stations. So this reduces fluctuation. We combine photovoltaic with biogas. So this gives also balancing between different hours in the during the day and during the night. And what we have also learned, we have to get the acceptance of the public. This is a very important thing. I thought of the DC lines. It was very long not discussed in the public what our utilities want to do. And then to have no acceptance of the new technologies. Everyone wants to have new energy, but no one wants to have transportation systems close to the village or to the house. And then the argumentation is we need cable systems. The price of cable system is 10 times higher than the price of an overhead line. But no one wants to pay not 25 euros cent, but 50 euros cent for transportation. Today, pay for every kilowatt hour, prices are roughly 25 euro cent, 6.5 cent for renewables. And no one wants to pay more for this. This is the actual situation.
Can we wrap it up there so we can get around? Just a couple of comments. Thank you for sharing that. I'm amazed by the commitment of the German people to this transition. And especially Chancellor Merkel for making it happen. It is interesting to see the last 2 years here that GIZ has been partnering with USAID and NREL to have very deep and substantive discussions that have been during the deep dive workshops and during the forum itself. So now we're going to go to the way we're going to play this out, because we're running a little behind, we're going to go to Yongping and hear about his view of ADB's role and what he's thinking about. Then we're going to open it up for questions for about 5 minutes, some short questions, and then I'm going to ask all the panelists to give me two or three sentences about what they're going to take away from ACEF, what they learned here, what they heard here that they're going to work on. Okay, and so we'll wrap up in the next, say, 15 minutes or so. Yongping.
Okay, thank you, Peter. I have to... as you said, you called me energy, so I know you mean that I stayed too long here in this band. I spent 16 years in this same position, energy, for 16 years, and prior to that, 7 years in African Development Bank. So I always say I spent 25 years in ADB in both places. Now, since I stayed so long, that I remember a few things I share with you here. I can go recall the time that when even Dan Millicent was still with us as a colleague, and we used to have a position called the Clean Energy Specialist, that we had to, this year, we had to replace this person's position. And I wrote through our DG to BPHR that we don't need any clean energy specialist anymore because everyone is clean now. Every energy specialist is clean energy specialist. So we decided to just replace this position with the title of energy specialist, that's it. So you can see, imagine that since 10 years, how much renewable energy, clean energy has been mainstream. I was fascinated by my neighbor, Mr. Edwin's talk about Germany's experience. That's great news, great breaking news. But at the same time, I would like to bring some development story also from our side. Just before we started this week, the whole Energy Week, I received an email, I think Brianna got a copy of the email from one energy director of Southeast Asia. He wrote to me saying that we heard about the solar cost of solar has dropped so much, but why in my country, my region, things are not happening? Why? Why countries don't feel that solar is cheaper? Why countries are not investing in solar or wind or renewable energy? I'm sure if I say this, people would remind me last year, 2015, it was a record year for renewable energy. And more than half of that, 60% of that, came from Asia Pacific. It's very true. But if you look at the composition of this 60% of $260 billion, mostly coming from two countries, China, India. And the rest of Asia, actually, they are the investment in 2015 in the rest of Asia was less than a year before, if you look at the numbers very carefully. So what's going on? I think president of ADB, when he opened this forum on Wednesday, he mentioned three barriers: policy, technology, and cost. I would like, at the end of the day, I think cost is an issue. I want to mention today here, I want to just talk a little bit about the cost of renewable energy. It's very true that since 5 years, the cost of solar dropped more than 80%, wind maybe by 30%. I checked the latest number of the it's a Bloomberg renewable energy finance, and the globally, on average, the cost of solar PV, levelized cost, is about $1 per kilowatt hour. The cost of wind is about $0.8, that's 80 cents, US cents per kilowatt hour. However, BNEF gave the cost of fossil fuels, also coal-fired power plant, without price and carbon. The coal-fired power plant cost is 61 US cents per kilowatt hour, the levelized cost. In fact, the cost of coal has dropped more than 30% also over 1 year. It's also changing. So I think that's some of the reasons that it's very challenging, still challenging. We can still say that renewable, in spite of this progress, the costs are still perceived as high, particularly in other developing countries other than China and India. I look at the number for Vietnam, for example, because BNEF gave different numbers to different countries. Vietnam's levelized cost of solar in Vietnam is $1.6 per kilowatt hour. It's very, very expensive. So things are not happening because cost is still an issue. Now, question, what shall we do? I think we should work on policy. We should wait for technology. We should bring the technology to these countries. And we should do something. I want to highlight two initiatives ADB is doing to make these things happen, maybe faster. One is ADB's president and management decided to create an expert pool in ADB. So Brenda, myself, our group will be joined by one expert in smart grid, specialized in smart grid, but with the deep knowledge of renewable energy integration, integrated storage. So that this new specialist, energy specialist, will help ADB and ADB's foreign country to design the new generation of project with renewable energy at an affordable cost, hopefully. But as I said, these countries are facing in a different context. Unless they have their own local technology, local manufacturing capacity, their own technology, if they have to import these solar panels, this will be still expensive. So the another initiative I want to cite, as actually Athena from WRS just mentioned, that we have this workshop, deep dive workshop on accelerators and incubators. It was ADB's initiative to bring these clean tech innovators to ADB to showcase the new technologies and what kind of new technology that can be deployed at affordable cost to developing Asian countries, developing countries. So that's another initiative. I'm glad that it's been noticed as a great success. I really want to make that an example how ADB can help member countries bring solar, wind, and renewable energy at an affordable cost. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that. So we've covered a lot of area, and we want to hear from you. I mean, we've covered climate finance, advocacy, policy. We've covered development. We've covered off-grid energy access on the agenda. We've covered how to re-engineer the German power system. We've covered how ADB can re-engineer itself. So that's quite a lot. But we really want to focus in on what's on your mind, what questions you have. Just a few ground rules. I'd like to, since we are running a bit behind, I'd like to ask you to keep the questions short. I'd like to ask you if you have a comment, that's fine, but keep it less than 30 seconds. And I'd like to ask the answers to be brief. So we're here to hear from you. Yes, and please, when you come up, please just introduce yourself. You can just walk up to the microphone. You don't need to wait to be called.
You have the end users looking at low cost, and then there's the development group that looks at social good. How do we bring these three together to make all of this work so that we can easily transition to clean energy? I mean, that's a question for anyone.
Very nice, concise question. I hope you have a concise answer here somewhere. Anyone want to take this?
We try and answer that question. But it's a I don't know if you try and bring them together. I think the issue that we're facing is to make sure that each of us individually works to make sure that the incentives are there for the private sector to want to step in, that the safeguards are there for us to make sure that that excess that happens doesn't leave people behind. And Rachel Kai spoke to that quite a bit. And I do think that it's our individual roles that kind of add up to the whole that's going to make it a better future. I don't think this is necessarily thing. We're never going to get the private sector to drop the profit motive. That is why they're here. This is why we want to incentivize it. It's really on us, the rest of us, to make sure that those investments are in areas that we deem appropriate.
I think the private sector must make profit. Like you say, that's why they're here. And they must, in case of rural access, they must make profit, but at the same time, they should be, they must make profit in providing access to the poor. The point is that the poor is already spending a lot of money on energy services. And oftentimes, it's really a question of re-engineering that expenditure in a line in cash flow that matches with what's profitable. So it's possible, and we've seen it in a number of cases. What really is required when you are talking to the poor is to mitigate the risk of operating at that level.
So I just have two microphones in my hand. I have just something to add to that, an ADB project where it could have been a very sort of boring project where you install mini grids and serve 2,000 households, but instead we designed it. I was a consultant, next in working for the Asian Development Bank in Myanmar, to do off-grids with tenders where businesses bid with a three-year contract to provide power to minimum levels. And the price of that the villagers were paying for their services went from about $4 or $5 down to about $1 per kilowatt hour. Yes, sir.
My name is Gurchad. I work with GIZ in Pakistan. So my question is to Mr. Zai, referring to the cost of the renewable energy per kilowatt hour. So if I heard you correctly, you mentioned the cost of solar, $1.61 per kilowatt hour, and wind like 0.80 cents per kilowatt hour. So because we had this discussion and the solar can be generated now through auctioning in Dubai, for instance, the latest auction of just 3 cents per kilowatt hour. And you know, there are auctions in South Africa and the South America that now, you know, the renewable energy solar PV can be generated at 6.5 cents. So can you please just a little bit explain? Thank you.
I'll be very, very brief because it can lead to a very long discussion how these numbers came up. I cited a number given by Bloomberg New Energy Finance, and they are specialists in calculating levelized cost per kilowatt hour, which is a little different from the auction that the bidders would come up with subsidies in mind. So we are talking about the difference in, talk about an average globally. So it's different from a specific auction in a specific location. But globally, I know the costs are dropping very, very fast, and I'm just hoping that can go even faster.
I think you can take that up afterwards bilaterally. We have any other questions? Yes, sir. Feel free to challenge us. We don't want to end up with just happy talk.
There was an article about, you know, how $286 billion has been invested in 2015 in renewable energy. There's a follow-up which says that, you know, there's only a 15% capacity utilization because there's renewable energy which we understand. So one of the things that we have to see is how best we can sweat the assets in a manner that we get more out of this that can further reduce the cost and make it more competitive.
Anyone want to take that? Can you clarify the question?
Yes, the question is that how we go about doing it more competitive in terms of making the assets utilization in a much better manner and in a manner that you know, we get more out of the investment than what we are getting.
Oh, so increasing the utilization factor.
Yes, because at $286 billion, you get 15% of capacity utilization.
Okay,
if
so
you go by that article.
Right, so the question is, $280 billion of investment in renewable energy is discounted by the fact that the utilization factor may be only 15 or 20%. Do you want to take that?
I hope I understand your question. I think the production factor is a fraction, it's a maybe 25 minutes. We have an expert here.
What we do in Germany is the exchange, the size of the wind generators. Typically, we reduce the size. We change the blading of our generators so that we are able for wind generation to come from 2,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt installed to 3,000 kilowatt hours per kilowatt installed. This is a continuous process that is done in Germany.
Okay, we'll stop with that. Yeah. Other questions? Jan, do you want to introduce yourself, please?
There's a word called the party pooper, and I'd like to take that role for a second because I feel that quite often in the community of energy specialists. We have these conferences, and the closing remarks of those conferences, seem to be quite often very upbeat. There's a lot of momentum, and we all go back home patting ourselves on the back, saying, "This is really going in the right direction." And all I can think of quite often is that we're going in the right direction, yes, but not at the right speed, because there is a tremendous gap, and we know that from just doing the numbers on the Paris Agreement, which is a weak agreement, which doesn't even get us to the 2 degrees. So we're on the way to environmental bankruptcy. I would like to perhaps quickly ask the panel if there are any thoughts on how we close that gap, and not just focus on the direction, but the actual speed that's required, and the way a company would focus on what they need to do to get to break even. How do we get to break even?
Okay. In the interest of time, I'll identify one panelist brave enough to answer each question. Athena.
I'm not going to answer your question. I'm going to agree with you. And I think one of the things I said at the beginning was that there was a lot of emphasis on scale and scalability of initiatives. But the other message I would emphasize is the sense of urgency. We don't have a lot of time, right? And so let me just take Southeast Asia as an example and the Philippines as an example. We were part of the High Ambition Coalition in Paris. We championed the 1.5 degree aspirational goal. And then we go home and you look at our energy plan and it is not Paris compatible. And I'm from the Philippines, so I can say this. And so we have now undertaken through the government's Climate Change Commission, very ambitious, bold policy review of our energy policy, because we are realizing that given the vulnerability of the Philippines and our energy options, we cannot produce and consume energy the way we've done business as usual. So this is a fundamental policy shift. This is a big signal. And I'm convinced, and I've said this in one of the parallel sessions, that with the cost of technology going down, with the competitiveness of geothermal, wind, and solar, and we have all the studies, all the experts in this room that prove the economics of this, with all the entrepreneurial and brilliant accelerators in this country, with support from our Asian neighbors, particularly China and India, we could grow and produce and consume energy in a different way. But it takes political will, you know. So this policy signal is to be translated in regulation, enabling environments, in legislation. And I think we can do it. And part of the movement building in this country is all the stakeholders want this to happen. So it is this amalgamation of efforts in this room. All the stakeholders have to push and charter this new change, because as you said, we don't have a lot of time.
Thank you. Yes, go ahead.
I want to apologize for citing a number while I'm thinking the question he asked. Actually, I put one decimal
wrong place. Yeah.
Wrong place. It should be 10 cents, US cents, and 10 US cents for solar PV, 8 US cents for wind power, and 6 US cents for coal fire.
And I know why you did that, because they're often reported in mills. And so you read the Bloomberg, it's 8.5 mills, which is 8.5. I didn't want to contradict.
Apologize for that.
Thank you for clarifying.
But still, that's higher than the auction.
Okay. One more question, and then we're gonna have a lightning round. Lightning round, I want 20 seconds from each of you about what you're gonna do this year, to what you're taking away and commit to. Okay, 20 seconds, because we don't wanna bore them with another full round, but I wanna end up upbeat, something we're gonna, we'll start from, he's gonna ask you a question after the question, then we'll do the lightning round. Yes, sir.
Satya Kumar from Sri Shakti Alternative Energy Limited, India. According to analysis by IEA, when the interest rate is more than 9%, 50% of the tariff goes for debt service in the case of solar. So when you have the Paris Agreement, GCF, or the multilateral finance, and when investing in clean energy is the right thing to do, but then the finance from multilateral funding agencies, private capital, all that comes attached to the country risk and all these things. So how can we overcome that when investment in clean energy is the right thing to do?
OK. Okay, so the debt risk carrying cost, do you want to take that, Yongping? Well, the question was basically that with very high interest rates and country risk, the cost of capital is very high, so the debt burden is a very much higher portion of the cost than it would be otherwise, which makes it a longer payback.
Thank you. Actually, give me a chance to rectify again what I made a mistake when I said in Vietnam it's $1.6, actually, so 16 cents per kilowatt hour, and 60% of that cost is because of financing cost. It's in Vietnam is higher because the local interest rates are higher. So that's a developing member countries that do have these issues. The financing costs are very high. I heard once in China, one of these forums, one investor says he doesn't need any feed-in tariff or government support if he had the interest rates as low as Japanese companies are paying. So in Japan. So these financing costs are very, very much an issue. I think so ADB as a developing financial institution, we do have a role in there to bring our contribution, but it's not enough. We said that ADB is going to bring the $6 billion in climate finance, but the total requirement would be $160 billion plus in just those countries who submitted the INDC, we made a rough calculation. So it's not enough. So we count on private sector. And this private sector initiative I just mentioned, the incubators, accelerators, they are the entrepreneurs. They will bring affordable solutions, and then there will be investors coming in to work together with ADB and also development partners like USAID and others.
And I think you asked a very difficult question, and you may not get an answer, a full answer today. Thank you. Okay, so lightning round. I commit, in 20 seconds, I will tell you what I commit to, how to bring more investors here to ACEF next year. I have some ideas on how to do that. I was sharing some thoughts with people about having expanding the Energy for All Investor Forum, but we actually have fewer investors than we've had in the past. That's my takeaway. Lightning round. Athena.
Because I interact with a lot of climate finance first holders, both multilateral and bilateral, I commit to bringing them to the table and match them with the ambition of countries that have put forward very ambitious clean energy targets as part of their national action plans.
So something we've discussed actually with quite a few people in the last couple of days is this idea of bringing more of our the slower moving sectors like utilities and more of the power sector, and putting them and literally pitting them against the newest of innovation, newest of technologies. And I commit to trying to make that happen next year. Right. Sorry, minus the try, I'm committing to make that happen next year.
In trying to scale energy access, I'm firstly going to work towards getting more people from other sectors like health and so on into this discussion in energy access, going to work more with utilities, and I'm going to try to convince ADB to launch a large multi-country cooking energy program.
Yeah, I had a lot of very fruitful discussions, and in some discussions I have the impression that we need more cooperation between the financials and the technical guys, and hopefully we can combine this in the future a little bit better so that the investment can be targeted more than we do now.
Thank you. I want to just say that we in Asia developing countries we are facing two challenges. One is energy access, the other one is going for low carbon. And these two objectives are not always going exactly the same direction. When there's so many people still suffering from energy access who don't have any access. I think a single solution, there's no single solution. There's no one fuel can satisfy 100% on both objectives. And so I'm a believer of a healthy, a rational energy mix in which renewable energy will take as much as possible in that energy mix. And we have to work on the other part of the energy mix to make them cleaner, and that's what we're trying to do.
Thank you. And with that, I'd like the audience to thank the speakers. And okay, thanks. You can take your chairs. We're going to feel like a game show host or something. We're going to move over here and get our favorite closing plenary speaker, Ralph Sims, up here. But before, I want to make it known that it's not often, in fact, I don't think we've ever invited the same final keynote speaker back a second time. I told Ralph, I set the bar for you, I told him we wouldn't invite him back a third time, but if he knocks it out of the park, we can have an instant poll at the end. Okay. Ralph's bio is on the website. He is a professor of sustainable energy at the University of at Massey University, and he's got a wealth of experience across the energy sector. He plays a key role in the JEF Global Environment Facility Technical Committee. He's well-versed, and he has a very fertile, broad mind, and he's going to tie a few loose threads together for us. And you've got, you still have your 20 minutes. We are running 20 minutes behind, but we're not going to cut you off. Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thanks very much. It's an honor to be invited back. And I had a little hesitation when I did get an email, because this is a great conference. And all credit to the organizers. I've learned a lot the 3 days I've been here. I missed the deep dive workshop because I was in Amsterdam at the European Union Biomass event, which had a similar number of people, actually, and it was actually quite stimulating, too. So Peter's given me the title here, The World of Energy Post-Paris. I was in Paris for 2 weeks, and I learned a lot from outside the negotiating rooms. There was a lot happening there as well. And so the stipulation was, though, that I'm not allowed to use the same slides that I used last time, Peter said. But now that I've found 65% of people who are here for the first time, I might have got away with it. But anyway, I'll whip through and see where it gets me. I did realise, having seen the board behind me here, I'm actually wearing the same jacket as last year, which is a bit of a worry. So what's happened since the last ACEF? Let's whip through these. Some of them you know. World population's increased by 78 million. 2000 was the warmest year ever recorded. Extreme weather events in Paris and Sydney in the same week, just last week, were inundated. Around 30,000 elephants killed illegally for ivory, mainly for the Asian markets. 470 million people moved into the cities. About 1.3 million a day are moving into cities. Global Environment Facility financed 26 climate change mitigation projects, some with ADB. Emerging countries invested more in clean energy than developed countries. Thousands of migrants fleeing into Europe, environmental migrants, some of them. There's more cars in Manila now. It took me 2 hours and 7 minutes to get to ADB for the airport this time. It was only 1 hour 53 minutes last year. So I don't think I'm coming again, even if I'm invited. So over 300 million people gained energy access. Tesla batteries hit the market, and their EV sales grew 50%, electric vehicle sales. Donald Trump's aiming to be the next United States president, and if so, he's going to renegotiate the Paris Climate Agreement. Amazing. Sea level rose 3.3 millimeters, confirmed by satellite and surface data. 286 billion invested in renewables, we've heard. Global energy related CO2 emissions leveled out at just over 38 million tons per year. This is IEA data. So there is a sign that we're leveling out the CO2 emissions. Peter DuPont moved from Nexen to USAID. Jessica from Nixon, her daughter's passed her school exam, so she hasn't got the results yet, but I'm sure she will. Now, those are actually the two most important things that happened last year. These other two weren't very important, but I've mentioned them anyway. Sustainable Development Goals and the Paris Climate Agreement. So that's in a year. And if you remember Bob Dylan's song, if you're old enough, for the times they are a-changing, because that's certainly the way the world's going. 175 nations signed the Paris Agreement. I urge all countries to move quickly to ratify the agreement at the national level so it can enter into force as rapidly as possible. Ban Ki-moon. 17 countries have already ratified, mainly the small island development states. To enter into force, the agreement needs a combination of at least 55 countries and over 55% total emissions. What does that actually mean? These graphs come from ICG international climate policy. This is one example. If China, US, and European Union all sign up, then maybe Brazil, Mexico, South Africa, and any other 49 parties, and we've cracked it. But without the European Union, which is unlikely, Hungary has already had a unanimous decision in its parliament. France, 2 days ago, had a unanimous decision to ratify. So Europe's going. Without Europe, we can still get there with a different mix of countries, but still China and the US in the mix. And if China and the US don't sign up, then we can still get there as long as a lot of other countries get there too. So these are just examples of how we can get there. In relation to John's Carbon Trust comment before, the current INDCs are totally inadequate and we've got to do a lot better. This is the UNFCCC graph, which shows if this mouse works, does it work? No, I can't get the arrow to go, never mind. The INDC ranges for 2025 and 2030 are based on what is in them that's been assessed. But we need to do much better if we're going to get to the 2-degree scenario, and certainly the 1.5 that came out of Paris as well. So many of these INDCs are conditional financing. We require something like 4.4 trillion investment to get there over the years, which is huge, which is absolutely huge. The gap between INDC pledges and what is needed to be on the pathway has been bridged by the IEA. And they so the INDC, going back to that graph there, if you drew a line through the two INDCs, that's the INDC scenario, and compare with the 2 degree C scenario, which is the bridge scenario. So this is the IEA analysis, how do you bridge the gap? And this is what they've come up with, and I'm sure some of you have discussed this week, because energy efficiency is high up there, as we know. But look at this other one, fossil fuel subsidy reform. We've mentioned that a few times this week, and that's a 10% difference. What does that mean? In Paris, the New Zealand Prime Minister John Key, who's not my favourite Prime Minister, presented a communique from the Friends of Fossil Fuel Subsidy Reform to the UNFCCC Executive Secretary Christiana Rivera. So there's 44 countries are friends of this. And incidentally, if you didn't know, Christiana's daughter is a delegate here today, or this week, which I think is wonderful. I don't know where she is, but anyway, I had a chat with her yesterday. The IEA Executive Director, Fatih Birol, in Paris, who I used to play football with, I know that because I was at the IEA for 4 years, so he's a good striker, is Fatih. Anyway, he made the point, fossil fuel subsidies presently provide support for fossil fuel combustion that equates to around $110 a tonne CO2. That's a subsidy from the fossil fuel subsidies. The typical current carbon price, however, to increase the current the cost of fossil fuels is about $10 a tonne. How can we get that offset into place? We've got to get rid of these fossil fuel subsidies. And thinking beyond plastic, this is a wonderful photograph, I think. It's quite, this is a guy in a boat in a sort of sea of plastic. Why, the reason I put that there is, as we were looking, this is a quote from Think Beyond Plastic, as we were looking for the global numbers, we discovered a huge correlation between associated plastic pollution and fossil fuel subsidies. Subsidies are highest in Asia, as is plastic pollution. And that region also has got the greatest contribution to ocean plastics. We're working, the Jeff is working with Think Beyond Plastic to see if that's a true correlation there, but it does get you thinking about the fossil fuel subsidies. So anyway, now the Paris Climate Agreement's been signed, we need to do something. And this is what we've sort of talked about the last few days. I've got 7 points here of things we're going to do, and I'm going to rocket through them sort of 1 minute each, hopefully. IPCC special reports in response, the request is in the Paris Agreement. So I'm involved with the IPCC, and we do have a scoping meeting for the 1.5 degrees. It wasn't in this fifth assessment report to any great degree, simply because the science and the analysis hadn't been done. So the modellers are beavering away looking at that as we speak. Second report's on oceans and cryosphere. Third one's climate change. This is the title. Climate change, desertification, land degradation, sustainable land management, food security, and greenhouse gas fluxes in terrestrial ecosystems. Anybody know what that means? What it actually does mean is agricultural emissions, but Saudi Arabia and Brazil in the same room couldn't accept that. So that's what it's come up with anyway. So that's the third one that's going to occur in another couple of years' time. We have got a capacity building initiative for transparency, so this is the second action. Paris Agreement includes a provision on enhanced transparency of action and support, aim is to build mutual trust and confidence in the country-led approach. This is coming out of the agreement. Many countries lack capacity to effectively monitor, report, and track any progress made in the information and the implementation of their NDCs. So therefore, the request went to the JEF to establish this CBIT as a new financial initiative to support recipient countries meet their transparency requirements. And just 2 days ago, 3 days ago now, a new trust fund was approved by the JEF Council, where I should have been this week, but I chose to come here as priority. That's a much better option. So there's around a $50 million pledge for this activity. So the JEF is working and will obviously liaise with ADB and all the other agencies as well. Delaying mitigation actions is not an option. Look at this graph here. It's sort of symbolic, but for a sector to get to zero emissions at some time in the future, if you delay actions, that's what the curve looks like until you eventually get a steeper decline going into the distance. If you get early mitigation and rapid peaking pathway, you end up at the same point of zero emissions, but look at the difference between the two graphs. And the area under those two graphs is the total CO2 or greenhouse gases that's produced over that period. So the sooner we act, the better it is. Bioenergy has been talked about here, it's certainly got a part to play. The deep dive waste to energy and cookstove sessions particularly covered it. Modern biomass, however, I didn't see many papers on that or hear many this week. But the statement from IPCC, fifth assessment report, bioenergy can play a critical role in mitigation, but there are issues to consider such as sustainability of practices and efficiency of the systems. It's very controversial. This was a letter in the Washington Post from 65 scientists in the US criticizing the US Senate for having some statement on woody biomass in the legislation. And they all signed this and they were quite anti having any more biomass. So there's good biomass and there's bad biomass. A quote from this report, while forest biomass energy may be renewable over the long term, it is not a low carbon source of energy like solar panels. Using the same amount of land area, solar panels produce up to 80 times as much electricity as wood burning, but with no emissions at all. Slightly biased view, you might say. I did visit a farm in the UK just last week where they've got a 60-acre, 25-hectare block of solar PV there. They're making far more money out of that than milking cows, which was what the place was before. But of course, it's heavily subsidised. It's owned by a Chinese company. And there it is, you can graze your sheep underneath as well, so you can still make some wood. Linking solar PV in particular with electric vehicles is being done worldwide. I mean, in Amsterdam, just on Monday, no, Sunday actually, I got a taxi from the airport and it was a Tesla, a fully electric Tesla taxi. I thought that was wonderful. They didn't charge me anymore, but it was pretty impressive cruising around in that. But I've got my own electric vehicle, and I think many of you should get something similar. It's called a solo wheel, and it goes at 18 kilometers an hour, and it goes a 10 kilometer range, and when you get to where you want to go, or the bus, you just bend down and pick it up. That's me in my garden practicing, because I haven't quite got it off yet, because it's not easy to do. But anyway, everybody should have a solo wheel. So I've got a question though. Just put yourselves at home. It's a typical day. You're going to leave home and you're going to go to the office or to your workplace. Just put your hand up if you normally go the main part of the journey on a bus. Nobody goes on a bus. One, two on a bus. Anybody go on a train or a light rail or a metro? That's encouraging. Who goes on a bicycle? That's encouraging. Well, that's sort of encouraging. Who walks? That's not too bad either. And who goes in a car? Be honest. And of those people, put your hand up, leave it up, there's only one person in the car. The reason I'm asking this is because if everybody in this room isn't walking the talk, if we're not reducing our personal emissions and criticizing our friends who buy fancy new SUVs when they don't really need them, then how are we ever going to make progress? So there's a challenge for everybody here to think about what we do and set an example, because we know what the problem is. Most people walking around and never have got no idea. So unless we start it, we're not going to get anywhere. In fact, I did figure out as well, if you're in a car for an hour a day to work and an hour back again, or maybe 2 hours in Manila, that's about 5 or 6% of your total life spent in traffic jams. So think about it. Land use competition, Peter, you have to give me a nudge when I've got a few minutes left, I think. Anyway, land use competition is a concern. In New Zealand, for example, we're increasing the land area of plantation forests and allowing regeneration of our natural forests, and that would offset a quarter of our total greenhouse gas emissions over the next few decades. But of course, it competes with land for food production for export. The picture there is actually my forest, and it was planted 20 years ago. It's 200 acres, so about 80 hectares. I've got the carbon, a fifth share, I've got the carbon credits, 13,142 credits from the New Zealand government under the emission trading scheme. So I can sleep at night. My trees are absorbing my carbon dioxide. And the good news is I've got credits in excess. So if anybody wants to do a deal when we finish here this afternoon, current rate's about 12.4 euros, I think. So come and talk to me, because I've got credits to sell. In terms of food, we need to transition away from animal proteins to vegetable proteins. There was a session, track four session today covered a lot of this. Technology now, the biotech guys in the lab with big investment are making synthetic meat from vegetable proteins, adding about 3% of animal proteins for flavor. And that's the future food, maybe. And then the 3D printing of this synthetic meat turns it into a rump steak. It looks like a rump steak, it smells like a rump steak, it tastes like a rump steak, but it's not, it's vegetable protein. So we don't quite know where this technology is going to take us, but this is really happening quite fast. But as was also mentioned, we fail to consume one third of all the food we produce. And just looking at the receptions the last couple of days, which were wonderful events, networking, but who ate all that food that was left over? I mean, I tried to do my bit and eat as much as I could, but what happens to it? Hopefully it's not just thrown away. We fail to consume one third of all the food we produce. Another report's just come out from the FAO I was involved with, looking at renewable energy, energy efficiency in the food supply chains, and we know we can do it better. About a third of the total end-use energy in the world goes into food production, and about a quarter of the greenhouse gases come out in the not food production, supply and cooking, etc. as well. So we know we can do it better. I've got this one here, which is mainly adaptation and resilience. This is a page that came out from the STAT report to council just on Tuesday of this week. Not going to go into details, but it's designing projects in a rapidly changing world, how to get adaptation and resilience into those projects. It's aimed at the food supply sector and the food security, but it is available for, and it could be used for cities or for a whole range of mitigation systems when you're also looking at adaptation. The methodology there I can highly recommend. Black carbon I heard mentioned once this week. It's a short-lived climate pollutant, and if we look carefully, we can slow the rate of global warming. I'm not going to spend much time with it. We did put out this report at STAT this year, and it's aimed at projects. So here's a chance for a discussion next year and deep dive workshop, because black carbon has certainly got a role to play. And the human health, whether it's from cook stoves or diesel engines, at the United Nations Environment Assembly 2 weeks ago in Nairobi, I was there at the cook stove side of it talking about black carbon. So it's sort of linked with what we're talking about here. Moving on, carbon dioxide capture and storage, combining it with bioenergy, offers the prospect of energy supply with large-scale negative emissions. This comes from the fifth assessment report. Plays an important role in many long-run stabilization scenarios, but it entails challenges and risks associated with both the upstream large-scale provision of the biomass, which has to be sustainable, as well as those risks associated with the CCS technology. So combining those together, it surprised everybody who wrote this report, including myself, that in chapters 6, 7, and 11, BECCS had a high profile. We cannot get down to 2 degrees centigrade without getting into negative emissions by before the end of this century, and BECCS is one way to do it. If you're not sure, just a quick diagram. Here's a power plant or an ethanol plant or a hydrogen plant. Fossil fuel in, useful energy services out, CO2 and pollutants out the stack. if we capture that CO2, then we've sequestered it and therefore the atmosphere is no worse off. But if we put woody biomass or some form of biomass in and we sequester that, then we can pull more CO2 out of the atmosphere when we regrow the crop that we've harvested as the fuel. And we can gain some carbon into the soil by a biochar at the same time. So this is a technology that we need to think about. IPCC report looked at coal on the left with its CCS, gas in the middle, and the two on the right are for switchgrass and woody biomass, and showing the negative emissions if we can capture that. So the key point here, though, that's relevant, is that my view, and I mentioned this in Amsterdam, is a BECCS demonstration plant should be the next step. And where's the place to do that? I think it's Indonesia. Indonesia's got a reputation for deforestation, it's got a reputation for its palm oil industry, it's got land areas that could grow biomass, and it would be wonderful if there's an ADB-funded BECCS plant in there with a bit of JEF support going as well, and so that when it's operating, people can say, well, if it works in Indonesia, it could work anywhere. And so that's a challenge for sometime in the future. We the quicker we get into this technology, the better. But last slide of significance, what do people actually want is a key that I've sort of missed here a little bit. Technology solutions, technical solutions, do they want that? The people wandering down the streets of Manila, or do they want the social benefits? And what do we mean by social benefits? These are the issues that people want happiness, but they want good health and clean water and all these other things as well. So linking those two together is communication, and that's what we need to get successful deployment of clean energy technologies. So behavioural change and social issues is an area that's sort of in the background of this event as far as I could see, and maybe needs a higher profile with some social scientists coming in next year as a possibility, perhaps. So is achieving the net zero emissions in the second half of this century feasible or an impossible dream? And I'm a sort of optimistic, happy sort of chap, but I do get a bit depressed and worried at times. So you can hear the politicians from this country say it is hard to have more ambitious NDC mitigation goals, country A could say, without dollars from the Green Climate Fund. Morocco is an example. I think their NDC wanted 50 billion, of which they've asked for 38 billion from the Green Climate Fund. It's only got 10 billion, and Morocco's only one small country. But so it's very conditional. Country B might say, without buying international carbon credit offsets, which is what New Zealand say, which is a total nonsense, which is why our Prime Minister and I don't get on too well at the moment. Country C might say, without accounting for forest sinks and land use change. The rules of that after Paris are still being negotiated. We don't know what they are yet. Country D, because our higher priority is to increase GDP growth and provide energy access for all, a point that was made earlier on. Country E, because we cannot gain political support across all parties, United States of America. But country F, since much of our export revenue comes from trading in oil, gas and coal, Australia, Saudi Arabia. There's all these excuses why, it's all a bit too hard, we'd like to, we've signed, and we might try and ratify, but that's the impression I'm getting. And finally, because our emphasis has to be on adaptation and investing in resilience to climate impacts, and that's the small island developing states, for example. So is it possible? What's the solution? And my view is that we really do have to emphasize the value of the co-benefits, which has been discussed this week quite considerably, but those are the ones that politicians need to concentrate on, as well as account for the cost of inaction. So my final thoughts, or in fact it's Ban Ki-moon's final thought, this covenant, this is about the Paris Agreement, must amount to more than promises. It must find expression in actions we take today on behalf of this and all future generations. That's my grandchildren expressing their actions there. They don't always look like that. So the world is rapidly changing. The NDCs have to be far more ambitious. Bioenergy black carbon emission reductions have mitigation potential. BECCS needs more detailed assessment. Social issues are as important as technical solutions. And finally, the co-benefits from climate change mitigation can be the main drivers for change and need to be better acknowledged in policy development. Thank you.
Okay, maybe we'll reconsider. So it's 4 o'clock, and that's the time we're supposed to end. We do have the iPads. Should we continue? Anyone? Do we have the iPad raffle? Yes?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes, come on.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Priyanta. Priyanta, you are on stage. My chair, my boss, Priyanta Wajayatunga, is going to oversee the process.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter. First of all, let me thank all of you for hanging around here. You know, we have already had almost 5 days of information bombardment all throughout, but I presume all of these deep dive sessions have been very, very useful, and then 3 days of main forum, and with all that, thank you very much for hanging around for the last session, and of course, partly maybe because of iPads. Now we have come to the, the raffle draw, where we will be distributing iPads, and these iPads, as you know, have been sponsored by Trans Energy and CTC Global together. And shall we start off now? Please stand. Let's start. There you are. 852472. Is it in the auditorium? We will wait for 30 seconds and then move on to the next one. 52472. Anybody? Please stand up if you are around. No? Okay, let's move on. I can see. Okay, next one. 524780. Okay, next one. 52530. Yeah. Next. 52606.
Okay, thank you.
We are not done. Not quite. So, this is the closing, bringing everything together. Before I introduce Manish Papana, I just wanted to thank the people behind the scenes, the people who you see running around, taking care of problems, setting up the rooms, making sure the PowerPoints are in place, making sure if any little thing happens, they fix it, making sure the sound works, all of these things. Planning for months, and so Connie, are you here? Connie was so embarrassed. Anyway, Connie Sayan, Cowogs, the Advanced Management Unit, Martin Block. Just please give a hand to all of the people who helped. And so now we have two final speakers. They'll be brief, but it's nice to end with some thoughts and ideas from two of the organizers. The first will be Manish Papana, who's the Executive Vice President and Managing Director of WRI. And he oversees the programs, chairs the management team. And we are absolutely delighted that WRI came back this year. They went away for a little while and came back. And thank you, Manish, and you have the floor.
Great. Thank you, Peter. Wow, what an amazing week. I thought I was going to speak before the raffle, so I actually had a 10-minute speech because I had you where I wanted you, but I now realize I'm speaking after the raffle, so I'm going to make this much, much briefer. I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about two stories. One is about Steve Jobs. We just had the iPad raffle. You all know that Steve Jobs founded Apple. Most of you probably also know that Steve Jobs was fired from Apple shortly after founding. He was brash. He was temperamental. He didn't get along with the board. They fired him. Apple struggled for a while after that. For about 10, 15 years, it struggled. It was teetering on the edge of bankruptcy. And the board realized that the only person who could save Apple was Steve Jobs, and they invited him back. They wouldn't let him become CEO, so he self-proclaimed himself interim CEO. And at the very first staff meeting, he asked the staff, hey, what good ideas do you have? What breakthrough ideas? How are we going to get Apple up and running again? So the staff came and they pitched one idea after another, dozens of ideas came out of the scheme, so enough is enough. He went to the front of the staff meeting on a blackboard, drew this 2x2 matrix, and he said, we're going to, in the next few months, winnow down all these ideas to 4, and we're going to focus all our efforts on those 4 and really make sure that we deliver them and that they revolutionize the world. Steve Jobs' creativity, his attention to detail, and his relentless focus gave us the iMac, the iPhone, the iPod, and the iPad. Not that. And as we think about ACEF, now ACEF has been really 1,500 people, 5 days of remarkable ideas and creativity. But I think as we think a little bit about the challenges, and we think a little bit about implementation, can we pick a few big issues that came out of this? Can we actually not just wait till next year, but could we do some things in between this forum and the next forum? Can we begin to perhaps get more convenings in countries, get much more solution-oriented kind of conversations taking place in between the forums? Can we solve some of the big problems? We are now big enough, 1,500 people, in the most dynamic continent. Can we solve some of these problems? Can we turn this ACEF forum into an ACEF community, a real movement? And I think that would be a huge, huge thing. So the first story for me is a little bit about the creativity of the forum is phenomenal, but how do we take that a little bit more into delivering something on the ground? And I think, you know, Priyanka, Peter, the co-organizers have done a phenomenal job creating this community. Let's fully leverage it, right? Let's take full advantage of it between the forums. Let's see what we can do in between and create this community, this movement. The second story that I want to just kind of leave you with is that over the course of these past few days, I mean, I think we're all excited and energized about these bold goals, but a lot of people will say, can we achieve them? Is this realistic? Really genuine questions about, yeah, these bold targets are out there, but can we really make that happen? And I just want to kind of, argue that discontinuous change can happen. Radical change can happen. And I want to tell you a short story about maternal mortality, something in a different world than perhaps what many of you focused on, but maternal mortality, huge issue. One of the big Millennium Development Goals that were set back in 1990, for about 10 years, 20 years, very little had changed. That in a span of 10 years, maternal mortality rates declined by 50%. Remarkable success. So what were the ingredients that created this remarkable change? There were five elements that really spelled the success of this story. One was the accumulation of knowledge. There was a lot of work done about understanding what the impacts were of maternal mortality, the causes, the underlying problems, the potential solutions, and the effective implementation of those issues. The second kind of ingredient was a growing number of early kind of success stories. Some countries in some places were beginning to succeed in making a dent in addressing maternal mortality. The third point attracted political leadership. We started to have not just Millennium Development Goals, but we had some heads of state that started to talk about this. You had Kofi Annan, you had Gordon Brown, you had Jens Stoltenberg from Norway. And it led to, actually, the African heads of state collectively and their wives came together to really, really say, this is the time, this is the moment. The fourth ingredient recognized it needed to be a whole of government approach, that it couldn't just be the Ministry of Health that solved maternal mortality. They needed to bring in the infrastructure, planning, finance, different ministries together because you needed a whole of government solution. And the fifth and final ingredient, you had a growing crescendo of public support, mobilization, awareness. You had this thing called the White Ribbon Coalition, a real, real kind of crescendo of public outcry and demand that we solve this problem. And as we think a little bit about that success, it was truly a remarkable success. We think those same ingredients are starting to come together for us on clean energy, on climate change. And it's a remarkable moment. But that window, this political window that we have, is only going to last for about 2 or 3 years. And so I just think this community, all of us, just needs to take full advantage of this. We need to seize the moment. There is a real opportunity for us to do something that we may not believe, but can actually be done, which is to get us to that 2-degree, 1.5-degree goal. So with that, delighted to be here. Delighted to be co-organizing this once again with all of you. Thank you very much.
Invite Yong Ming up to make the final remarks.
Thank you, Peter, and I'm sure this will be the final. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. The 2016 edition of Asian Green Energy Forum comes to a close. As on behalf of the organizer, I would like to have just the final message to share with you. I heard from many of you actually in these days of this week feedback from you. That this year's ACEF has been a great success. Apparently, you like it, as that it's shown in the quick survey as well. But I asked why you say that it's been a great success. There are so many conferences in the world every day, in fact, in Asia. Myself, I've been traveling to Tirana, to Bangkok, to many Beijing, many conferences. What's unique here? This is what they told me. Here is a great place for networking. And these 25 tables in this hall that you have this knowledge networking, 8 minutes per round, and then it's been a fantastic networking. People really, really like it. I enjoyed it. I took some pictures, I shared in my social media, and people liked it as well. So I think that's a great, unique thing. Well done also, Peter and our organizers for suggesting that idea. I'm sure also they told me that here they meet real people like the CEO of small, medium-sized enterprises. There are also people that starting their startups with their very brilliant ideas and solutions in the renewable energy. Here also you meet, of course, you meet thought leaders like Manish just shared his idea, but you heard also ADB president, vice president, and Professor Sim's speech. So here it's a great place to have the interaction with the thought leaders in the area of renewable energy. And here also we need government officials. I'm a little bit myself surprised to see that the largest proportion of participants actually from governments. 30%, if you realize that it's a survey, at least in this form. So it's a great place to interact with government officials and to learn these British policy orientations in these countries. Here also we meet people from the finance world, including, I think this what is unique here, also you have here, having this conference here in ADB, you have access to ADB energy specialists. Now they become all clean energy specialists. You can talk to them and get project ideas, pipelines, so you can help to, you can contribute as whether you are a consultant, a contractor, suppliers, or developers, you all can have interaction with ADB staff and have this, explore business opportunities. To conclude, I think that this great event has been a success because of the strong support of our co-organizers, the USAID, WRI, and donors, many donors, partners, and I would like to thank you all for the generous support and contribution. Of course, Peter has mentioned that the appreciation should also go to the organizing team. Next, of course, our ADB team, Peter and Brenda, both of you have made tremendous effort, supported by your team. So, great hard work. Thank you so much for that. And lastly, and most importantly, once again, I'd like to thank the participation, active participation of so many people, so many speakers, over 1,500 participants from over 60 countries. So I'd like to thank you all for your time and active participation. I'm sure you'll bring back the knowledge you have learned here to your country, to your project, make a difference and make things happen. You will have the support of Asian Development Bank. I would like to briefly touch upon the observation from Professor Sims when he noticed the reception, the food in the reception. He wondered what would happen. Frankly, I don't know what has happened, but I'm sure that from next year, we'll propose a smart grid solution with storage, make sure that the food will be prepared and consumed in the most effective way. And also I noticed his suggestion on different technologies, including the CCS. And I think that we are interested in that kind of idea. We are willing to consider if there is a country with ownership in one country, we would like to support that. Of course, with the generous support from donors, Australia, I think one of them in CCS. With that, I would like to formally declare that the 2016 Asian Clean Energy Forum will close. We look forward to seeing you all in the project side of clean energy and maybe in Manila next year. Same week in June 2017, and see you all later next year. Thank you.